altitude 4.3 nautical miles, downrange distance 3 nautical miles. Engines throttling up, 3 engines now at 104%.
Challenger, go at throttle up.
Challenger, go at throttle up.
Seconds. Velocity 2,900 feet per second. Altitude 9 nautical miles. Downrange distance 7 nautical miles.
Now, this is a live picture from Cape Canaveral, Florida, of a parachute. I can't tell you anything more about that parachute because, to be perfectly frank with you, we don't know what that parachute is about. Now, let me repeat, because this story is in the, it's a breaking story, obviously an important story, a big story, the kind of news that no one wants to report. The Space Shuttle Challenger has been plagued by delays these last few days. This is the one that was to take up 7 people, in the astronauts, including the school teacher, who was put aboard as the first, actually, what we call strictly civilian person to be aboard a space shuttle. The space shuttle launch had been delayed for several days. It was a hard freeze in Florida overnight. No one is suggesting that that did or did not have anything to do with what happened to the space shuttle. Challenger, as you saw in that videotape we played, the launch seemed to go all right, but a minute and 12 seconds into the launch, something went wrong, and the report is that the vehicle exploded. Then you saw that live picture of the parachute coming down. And what we know is limited to that. Now, let's try to pick up Mission Control in Florida if we can. I'm not sure that we can, but I am hearing in my ear Mission Control with a, with an explanation. Let's try to pick up Mission Control.
Including ships and a C-130 aircraft. Flight controllers reviewing their data here in Mission Control. Provide you with more information as it becomes available. This is Mission Control, Houston.
Now, the information from Mission Control in Florida, and that was live from the Mission Control in Houston. Those of you who follow the space program know that the launches are made from Florida, but Mission Control is in Houston. Now, Mission Control explained, I'm not sure that you could hear that part of it, that the parachute you saw was a paramedic who was parachuting into the area in the water off the coast of Florida, where it was believed that possibly some of the debris from what is thought to be the exploded space shuttle was coming down. Understand the picture as best we can make it out. The launch, the delayed launch of the Space Shuttle Challenger went off this morning, and for a minute and 12 seconds, everything seemed to be all right. Then, apparently, reportedly, this is the word from NASA, the vehicle reportedly exploded. Now, we're going to roll the tape again for you of this morning's launch. As of this morning, this is the launch 10 seconds before the explosion. Let's listen and watch.
Challenger, go at throttle up.
Challenger, go at throttle up.
One minute, 15 seconds. Velocity, 2,900 feet per second. Altitude, 9 nautical miles. Downrange distance, 7 nautical miles.
It was at this point that something happened. The vehicle apparently exploded. Confusion at Cape Canaveral, scene of the launch, and some confusion at Mission Control in Houston.
Flight controllers here looking very carefully at the situation. Obviously a major malfunction.
Major malfunction being a euphemism in this case for a belief that the vehicle had exploded.
We have no downlink.
This is Dan Rather, CBS News in New York, with a special report about what apparently is an explosion of the Space Shuttle Challenger this morning, a minute and 12 seconds into the launch. Bruce Hall, our veteran CBS News correspondent, is in Florida. Bruce, I wanted to interrupt for just 1 second to, for those who are unfamiliar or have perhaps need a slight review, the way this the Space Shuttle goes up, this is the Space Shuttle itself. This is a model. These are the solid rocket boosters that Bruce is talking about. This is what we might call the main fuel tank. Check me as we go along here, Bruce. the one that is the main fuel tank that carries the shuttle riding piggyback aboard it. But these are the solid rocket boosters that actually are responsible for the early stages of the launch. Now, that being our little model and putting people somewhat in the picture, Bruce, if you'd continue as to what may have happened a minute and 12 seconds into launch when the space shuttle apparently exploded this morning.
Dan, it appeared that two things happened to us as we were watching. First, as it left the shuttle pad, it appeared to be one of the slowest liftoffs that any of us have seen. However, this is a different launch pad than they have used before. But as you said, at a minute and 12 into the flight, the solid rocket boosters, the two white tanks that you just showed us, normally just fall away at 207 into the flight. However, at about 112 into this, they went a different direction. They did not fall away. And within just a matter of 2, 3, maybe 5 seconds later, there was a major explosion, which appeared to be the shuttle itself and the main tank, which is still attached to the shuttle and would remain attached to the shuttle until it gets over the Indian Ocean. That normally drops over the Indian Ocean and the shuttle goes on into orbit from there.
Larry Speaks is now briefing at the White House, and we go directly to the White House for the Speaks briefing.
So once again, the president is concerned. He is saddened. He is very anxious to have more information on it. At the moment, as I say, we're learning most of our information from what the public is getting.
What is the best information as to the condition of the crew, Larry, at this point?
We don't have any more information than what is being provided the public on television. Hopefully later we will be able to get some, and that's the president's first priority, is to find out what information that is available. We just don't have any more. No, we have not from the Oval Office.
Will this affect in any way the plans for the State of the Union tonight?
I don't believe so. I'm certain that the president will feel compelled to mention this, depending on the outcome of what we learn here in a few minutes.
Will it affect the shuttle program?
Well, that's hard to say, here in 15 or 20 minutes after an incident of this type is concerned. I'm sure it will not affect the United States' determination to consider to continue the exploration of space and all the benefits we've received from it. While this is indeed tragic, it certainly will not deter the United States in its interest in space exploration.
For those of you who may just now be joining us, this is a CBS News special report. Dan Rather, CBS News in New York, with Bruce Hall, our veteran space correspondent, at Cape Canaveral in Florida. Space Shuttle Challenger apparently exploded into a gigantic fireball moments after liftoff today, about a minute and 12 seconds after liftoff. Apparently, and we say apparently because no one can know for sure, all seven crew members, including schoolteacher Krista McAuliffe of Concord, New Hampshire, may have been killed.
And it now appears, of course, that Krista McAuliffe could very well be remembered as the teacher who died in space. We have no confirmation of that, but there is no indication that there is any life that has been spotted among that seven-person crew today. McAuliffe's husband, Stephen, and her two small children, Scott and Caroline, were among the spectators at Cape Canaveral today to view the launch, what looked perfect for about 2 minutes, and then tragedy struck. The ramifications of this tragedy we can't yet realize, of course, this early on, but of course it is an enormous tragedy for the McAuliffe family, for the families of the other astronauts. It throws into grave doubt the future of the space shuttle program, which has been troubled recently. And of course, NASA will come under a great deal of criticism for this public relations effort that it has been making to get regular citizens into space. There's been a program for journalists that is now under consideration. Recently, Congressman Bill Nelson of Florida completed a trip. Before that, Senator Jake Garn of Utah went up. This program for teachers was announced by President Reagan during the course of his presidential campaign in 1984. Some people believe that it was an effort to win both the support of teachers and women, in that a woman teacher was picked for the experience. He said, in his defense, that he thought it would be an effort to share the space program with the children of this country so that teachers could share their educational skills after they have completed this trip. We have nothing further from NASA at this point. For those of you who are just joining us, the Space Shuttle Challenger today blew up about 4.5 miles downrange, about 2 minutes after its launch. John Palmer is in New York today. John, do you have any additional information for us there?
Not really, Tom. Of course, we're all waiting for the same thing, the fate of the seven astronauts aboard the Challenger, but we do know that three Coast Guard cutters, two rescue helicopters are now on the scene. The area where the splashdown took place, of at least we don't know how much of the shuttle Challenger was intact when it went into the Atlantic Ocean, but that position is given anywhere from 12 and a half to perhaps 28 miles off the shore. There are no U.S. Navy ships, we are told, in position there, but again, three Coast Guard cutters and two rescue helicopters. And a little bit earlier, we saw that parachute in the sky. That was one of the paramedics bailing out there over the scene. Again, as Tom said, and as we have heard several times now, the explosion took place about a minute or a minute and 15 seconds to be exact into the flight. All appeared to be going well, and then there was that tremendous, brilliant flash, the explosion, and we had two contrails, one going one way and one the other, one apparently the solid rocket dropping into the sea, the other the space shuttle Challenger. Earlier this morning, the delays were caused by the freezing conditions down in Florida. There were icicles, some people said as long as 2 feet, hanging from parts of the spacecraft, and there was a condensation problem, and they were a little bit afraid, and they delayed because this, they thought, might cause a problem of chipping of some of those sensitive tiles on the spacecraft if they should break off during the launch procedure. Well, the NASA officials talked this over for some time and decided to go ahead with the launch, that they didn't think that would cause any particular problem. Here is a picture of the crew, the seven astronauts aboard the Space Shuttle Challenger. Of course, the most celebrated passenger there is the civilian, if you will, the school teacher, Krista McAuliffe of Concord, New Hampshire. And there were a lot of reporters were up there this afternoon, of course, for the launch. They were in the high school auditorium with the students as they watched their teacher take off. And then, of course, as all of us that were watching noticed that there was something wrong, there was an explosion. The school officials didn't know what had happened, but they knew something had happened, and they suggested that all the reporters leave and all the students go back to their classes, and that's what happened. There is Krista McAuliffe, the school teacher, who is taking her flight. She was going to conduct 2 one-hour or so classrooms from space and be talking back to kids in classrooms all over the United States. The other crew members aboard that flight, along with Krista McAuliffe, the commander, was Francis R. Scobie, 46 years old. The pilot was Michael J. Smith, age 40. Judith Resnick, also on board, age 36. Ronald E. McNair, 35. Ellison Onizuka, who was 39. And Gregory Jarva, who was 41. That's Gregory Jarvis, 41. All in all, seven astronauts aboard the Space Shuttle Challenger. And again, Tom, we're just waiting here, as you are, for some word as to the fate of those aboard the Space Shuttle.
Reverend James David Ford leading the House of Representatives in a moment of silence.
May your spirit, O Lord, be with them, and may your love follow them and their families this day and every day, we pray. Amen.
This recognition for the seven crew members of the Shuttle Challenger. The Challenger exploding less than 2 minutes off the launch pad this morning. No official word yet on the fate of the seven crew members, but there is very little to hope for at this point.
I've just been thinking, Steve, as to why people at Mission Control, even people watching this on television, might not have been alarmed in the first instance, because about 2.5 minutes into flight, normally, when those big external tanks break off, we are accustomed now to seeing this great ball of fire as those two tanks and drop off and fall into the Atlantic.
Sitting here watching protectively, because we take these for granted now, that was the first thought of all of us. Hopefully, this is just an aberration on the normal separation that takes place. Obviously, it was much more than that. Let's look now at tape of the crew members as they arrived at Cape Canaveral last week.
Thank you very much.
Astronauts Judy Resnick, Ellison Onizuka, McNair, Greg Jarvis, and of course, Krista McAuliffe. And they teacher from New Hampshire.
They represent a great deal of the country too, as you look at their names and see them before the mission. Dick Scobie is from Washington State. Mike Smith was born in Beaufort, North Carolina. Judy Resnick was born in Akron, Ohio. Ronald McNair from Lake City, South Carolina. Ellison Onizuka was born on the island of Kona in Hawaii, and Greg Jarvis, who is the payload specialist on board the mission, was born, if I'm not mistaken, in Boston, but I'm not absolutely sure.
They had been waiting for this moment for quite a long time. This really should have been the sixth day of this flight. It was put off a couple of times last week because of bad weather in Africa and some of the alternate landing sites, and it was put off yesterday for mechanical problems. But it was that great rushing roar of sound, that too bright to look at light, that powerful thrust of all that energy going straight up and into outer space that we have watched on television over and over again. Seeing it for the first time this morning was a great rush, a great thrill. And then all of a sudden, as they got to about a minute and a few seconds into the flight, it became clear that something wasn't going right.
Engines at 65%, three engines running normally, three good fuel cells.
And they're about to take the engine power back up to achieve the lift all the way into the low orbit that they were looking for, the elliptical orbit that they take up before they start station keeping up there.
Engines throttling up, three engines now at 104%.
Challenger, go at throttle up.
Roger, go at throttle up.
Tom, it wasn't that visible from the ground, but at this point it was very clear. People were gasping, and you can see the two sides of the debris going out, almost looking like a pair of cow's horns, each curving in a different direction. Nobody was quite sure what we were looking at that point.
Yeah, Steve.
Except it was very clear that something was awfully wrong.
Yeah, the only thing that looked to be intact, to my naked eye at least, was one of the solid rocket boosters that seemed to be going off in one direction. But everything else seemed to have been virtually destroyed by the magnitude of that explosion at what appeared to be the base of the rocket. Of course, it's back there that the main engines are located.
That's where all the energy was being burned, and I think I heard somebody from the mission control in Houston say a few minutes ago that it was just after the three main engines to burn that this happened, and absolutely without warning. There was no anomaly, as they say. There was no indication here or from the things that the controllers were saying that anything was happening other than a great, dramatic, beautiful liftoff, as we've seen so many times before.
Now, this is normal motion. Now, close up, you see. Now, that's normal motion. Now, let's take slow motion coming back and watch the right side of one of those solid rocket boosters. And you'll see that the explosion apparently started on the right side of one of the solid rocket boosters. And then a few seconds later, the main huge explosion and fireball that just obliterated the Challenger. Let's take it in slow motion here, if we may. Now, re-rack that to show the slow motion. While they're doing that, when we say the solid rocket boosters, we're talking about these are the solid rocket boosters. And now, when we see it in slow motion, we can clearly see the explosion happened on the right side, first on the right side of one of those solid rocket boosters, and then there was the major explosion. Now, let's take a look at the slow motion replay. See the Challenger riding as it's supposed to. Then that small explosion on the right side of one of the solid rocket boosters, followed by the greater and main explosion.
Here is the shuttle itself. Here is Challenger. It lifted off from the ground, as you know, in a position like this, and was beginning to angle its way into orbit, going not only upwards, but going downrange. And these two solid rocket boosters, these solid rocket fuels, are the ones that you see, always see burning so brightly. At some point, about 2 minutes and 10 seconds into the mission, just about the time we saw the explosion this morning being a normal occurrence, these two rockets fall away, and the main engine continues to push the Challenger towards its orbit above the Earth. Now, as best we can tell by looking at the pictures, it is in here where the problem appears to have occurred.
No more than anyone else knows.
How would you react to
this? Terrible tragedy. Well, just enormous tragedy, and
what does this mean for the space shuttle?
Great concern for the families of people, a horrible feeling on all of that. Well, I think it's way too early to know that. I mean, it's been an extraordinarily, you know, viable program, and this is just a tragic thing, so I really don't have any detail on it.
When did the president...
Except the motion, saw the president was in there helped tell him about it and then went in afterward to see him, and his concerns are the same for the families and everybody else involved in all of this. Well, as just as I've described, with great concern for the families and no specific things on that. Yeah, and then I walked back in to see him just now.
You went in to tell him with whom?
Well, it's all over the, you know, just a whole bunch of people were in there when we walked in. He was doing some briefing, but then afterwards I saw him, and he's obviously very, very concerned about this.
What about the State of the Union tonight? The president, is it going to talk about the family? Is going to talk about the economy? Is it going to be a different speech now?
Well, the State of the Union speech will be held tonight at 9 o'clock at the regular time. Mr. Reagan had a reference in his speech already about the space flight. Of course, that reference has been deleted, and he's going to insert a new one. He will clearly begin with an expression of sorrow and sadness about what has happened today. What words he'll use, I don't know. I think they don't know at the moment. They're trying to discover exactly what they want to say about it. Then he'll go on with his regular speech. We asked him whether this wouldn't necessarily cast a pall over that speech, and he agreed it would, because clearly he was going to give a speech which was upbeat. He'd intended to say the State of the Union is good, things are very good, we're going to go forward. And tonight he can't really give that kind of speech without first talking about something that's happened that's very bad.
At the moment of launch, here is the McAuliffe family watching their daughter go into space. Those are her parents, her father, and her mother. And those, some of the school children, with their caps on. Her mother, clearly weeping with pride at that point. Children.
Oh, is that, are those the
at the Cape itself, very much like the children who had watched at Krista McAuliffe's school in New Hampshire, as described to us, for minutes did not know what was happening. It looked very much to us as if her parents did not know what was happening for some period of time.
Get on it, stay on it.
John Quinones, ABC's correspondent at the Cape, said to us earlier that in fact many people who were watching at the Cape did not know what was going on. Speaks at the White
Space
House.
Shuttle mission 51L. The president, in consultation with the leadership of Congress, has decided to postpone the State of the Union address that was scheduled for this evening. He will address the Congress and the American people on next Tuesday. The president, in addition, has asked the vice president to go immediately to Cape Canaveral's Kennedy Space Center, along with the acting NASA director, Bill Graham. The vice president will carry with him the president's personal concern for those courageous Americans who were aboard the space shuttle. In addition, the president will speak to the American people from the Oval Office later this evening regarding this tragedy.
Is it the president's view that perhaps an independent investigation outside of NASA is what is required on the pacing of the program and
I think
how
everyone,
it might affect this?
Everyone is leapfrogging well ahead of events at present. This tragedy is now only hours old. You have a series of actions taken by the president, including a charge to the director of NASA to find out what happened. And until we do some preliminary studies, none of these questions have answers.
In the wake of the explosion of the Space Shuttle Challenger at Cape Canaveral, Florida, this morning, shortly before noon Eastern Time, we take you now to the White House in Washington for a talk by the President of the United States.
15 seconds. Stand by, please.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'd planned to speak to you tonight to report on the State of the Union, but the events of earlier today have led me to change those plans. Today is a day for mourning and remembering. Nancy and I are pained to the core by the tragedy of the Shuttle Challenger. We know we share this pain with all of the people of our country. This is truly a national loss. 19 years ago, almost to the day, we lost three astronauts in a terrible accident on the ground. But we've never lost an astronaut in flight. We've never had a tragedy like this. And perhaps we've forgotten the courage it took for the crew of the shuttle. But they, the Challenger 7, were aware of the dangers, but overcame them and did their jobs brilliantly. We mourn seven heroes: Michael Smith, Dick Scobee, Judith Resnick, Ronald McNair, Ellison Onizuka, Gregory Jarvis, and Krista Mikulov. We mourn their loss as a nation together. The families of the seven, we cannot bear, as you do, the full impact of this tragedy. But we feel the loss, and we're thinking about you so very much. Your loved ones were daring and brave, and they had that special grace, that special spirit that says, "Give me a challenge, and I'll meet it with joy." They had a hunger to explore the universe and discover its truths. They wished to serve, and they did. They served all of us. We've grown used to wonders in this century. It's hard to dazzle us. But for 25 years, the United States space program has been doing just that. We've grown used to the idea of space, and perhaps we forget that we've only just begun. We're still pioneers. They, the members of the Challenger crew, were pioneers. And I want to say something to the school children of America who were watching the live coverage of the shuttle's takeoff. I know it's hard to understand, but sometimes painful things like this happen. It's all part of the process of exploration and discovery. It's all part of taking a chance and expanding man's horizons. The future doesn't belong to the faint-hearted. It belongs to the brave. The Challenger crew was pulling us into the future, and we'll continue to follow them. I've always had great faith in and respect for our space program, and what happened today does nothing to diminish it. We don't hide our space program. We don't keep secrets and cover things up. We do it all up front and in public. That's the way freedom is, and we wouldn't change it for a minute. We'll continue our quest in space. There will be more shuttle flights and more shuttle crews, and yes, more volunteers, more civilians, more teachers in space. Nothing ends here. Our hopes and our journeys continue. I want to add that I wish I could talk to every man and woman who works for NASA or who worked on this mission and tell them, your dedication and professionalism have moved and impressed us for decades, and we know of your anguish. We share it. There's a coincidence today. On this day, 390 years ago, the great explorer Sir Francis Drake died aboard ship off the coast of Panama. In his lifetime, the great frontiers were the oceans, and a historian later said he lived by the sea, died on it, and was buried in it. Well, today, we can say of the Challenger crew, their dedication was, like Drake's, complete. The crew of the Space Shuttle Challenger honored us for the manner in which they lived their lives. We will never forget them, nor the last time we saw them this morning, as they prepared for their journey and waved goodbye and slipped the surly bonds of earth to touch the face of God. Thank you.